Within the Father's house, the Son has found his home. And in his temple, suddenly, the Lord of life has come. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You boys are in a heap of trouble. I don't remember when I first heard that phrase. I'd like to think it was one of those Western movies that I grew up on as a young kid. But more likely, though, it was in my own house where there were three of us Moeller boys growing up. Added to the fact that my dad's cousin lived kitty corner from us and they had four boys in their family. Next door to us was a family with one boy, and across the street, two boys and one girl. With 10 boys in our four-house block, there was plenty of opportunity for us boys to get into a heap of trouble. I remember on one occasion growing up when Mom returned home from the grocery store. And she put away the groceries and she began preparing lunch for us boys. And when my five-year-old younger brother didn't respond, my mom sent me looking for him. And he wasn't in the house anywhere. So I went to the neighbors, checked with them. Always something going on at their houses. But didn't find him there either. So then I expanded my search out to the rest of the neighborhood and to the woods that were right down at the bottom of the street from us. And I could not find him. Not being able to find him anywhere, I headed back home. And upon rounding the corner of our house, I saw my little brother standing on the front porch with a police officer. Uh-oh, I thought to myself, that boy is in a heap of trouble. Well, as it turns out, he wasn't in trouble at all. For you see, my mom was the one who had left him at the grocery store. Some of you may remember those small booths of years ago at the grocery store where they showed cartoons and where parents would put their children to watch cartoons where they did the grocery shopping. So on that day, my brother went about the business of a five-year-old boy and sat in the booth and watched cartoons while Mom did her grocery shopping. And when Mom finished getting her groceries, she just plain forgot that she had her youngest with her. And so she checked out and left for home without him. It would seem that Mom had a lot on her mind at that time. And after having watched the full loop of cartoons, my brother went looking for Mom and realized that she wasn't in the store anywhere. So he went to the customer service department. They in turn contacted the police. And even though this five-year-old boy couldn't tell the officer his home address, he did know how to find his way home. And so he directed the police officer where to turn, street by street, until they found his way home. Leaving a child behind, you wouldn't think such a thing would be possible, but in the busyness of our daily lives, it is indeed something that can happen. Our gospel lesson for today tells the story of another young boy left behind by his parents who were so busy, but a child who also knew where his house was, his heavenly Father's house. And so at the age of 12, Jesus went along with his parents to the feast of Passover at Jerusalem, as was the custom for the boys that age. And after spending the required number of days at the feast, Mary and Joseph headed back for home, but without Jesus. Now, I don't think that Mary forgot that Jesus was with them. After all, on their trip to Jerusalem, it was very common that large numbers of groups would come and go, traveling to and from Jerusalem for the feast. And many traveled together for purposes of safety. And at times, the women would start the trip earlier, the men to follow, catching up at a later time. And it's so very possible that Mary thought that Jesus was with Joseph, and Joseph thought he was with Mary, or with some other friends or relatives. But imagine the worry and the fear that Mary and Joseph felt when dinner time came and Jesus was nowhere to be found. They began to search for him among their relatives and acquaintances, and when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem. 3 days they spent searching for Jesus. By now you can imagine that Mary and Joseph were frantic. But after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Mary said to Jesus, "Son, why have you treated us so? Your father and I have been searching for you in great distress." The boy Jesus appeared to be in a heap of trouble. But he wasn't really, because he had found his way home. And so Jesus answers, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I had to be in my Father's house?" Mary and Joseph didn't know. They did not understand what he was saying to them. For Mary and Joseph at that moment, it was all about the worry and the anxiety around them and that Jesus had caused them. "Son, why have you treated us like this?" But the boy Jesus knew. And he understood. And at the age of 12 years old, he knew where his heavenly Father's house was. And he knew he had to be there. From Luke 2:49, translated in the NIV version, says this, "Didn't you know I had to be in my Father's house?" The King James version reads like this, "Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business?" The Amplified Bible reads this way, did you not see and know that it is necessary as a duty for me to be in my Father's house and occupied about my Father's business?" The boy Jesus understood that God had business for him to do, the kind of business that would put Jesus, the man, in a heap of trouble. Being in a heap of trouble doesn't end with childhood, does it? Being in a heap of trouble knows no limits of age, no time, race, gender, or nationality. It runs from individuals through families, across generations, and yes, to nations. In the Old Testament, the people of God often found themselves in a heap of trouble, a nation divided, a nation conquered by a foreign people, and many of the people killed and the rest scattered. Their sin and their rebellion against God had put them into a heap of trouble from which they could not free themselves, trouble that affects all of life, going on day after day with no end in sight, like being in the middle of a storm that just won't end, or a war that you can see no end to. Take the example of Jacob in the Old Testament, for example. After stealing his brother Esau's blessing, Jacob fears for his life, and he flees from home. Jacob goes and hides, goes to his uncle Laban's house, and after 20 years of deceit and trickery, he flees from his uncle's house, and he heads back home to face Esau. And in the meantime, he wrestles with God. Aren't we fortunate that we do not face those kinds of trouble in our lives today? We know better, don't we? There is still that sin and that rebellion that puts each one of us in a heap of trouble with God. It is the story of our lives, isn't it? Like Jacob and the ancient Israelites, it seems like we're always in a heap of trouble, fleeing from the grasp of one adversity into the hands of another. And in between those moments, we spend wrestling with God. It's not just young boys who find themselves in a heap of trouble. That same sin and rebellion that brought so much trouble to the Israelites is also true for us today. It's not just all the things that are going on around us. Don't be confused. It's also those things that go on inside of us as we're still struggling with the same problems that sin and rebellion continue to bring. And we too know the sadness, the grief, the tears, the hurt, and the death that the ancient Israelites knew. And we still spend our time wrestling with God. And that spiritual stress can put us in a heap of trouble. A while back, I was listening to a Christian woman being interviewed on the radio. And during that interview, she revealed that she had come to a point in her life where she questioned and began to doubt the deity of Jesus. None of us are immune to such temptations to doubt. Doubt leads to worry. Worry leads to anxiety. And we need the words of comfort and hope, like Paul writes to us in the book of Ephesians from our epistle reading for today. He chose us in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption through Jesus Christ according to the purpose of his will. You see, the riches of grace are there for us because God had business to do, and Jesus understood the Father's business. As a boy, he found his way to the temple to do his Father's business. At his baptism, God declares him to be the Son, the fulfillment of the prophecy of a Savior. And then God sent his Son into the wilderness to begin the work of his Father's business. And as a grown man, Jesus makes another trip to Jerusalem and to the temple, once again to be about his Father's business. And Jesus again appears to be in a heap of trouble because this time there is those who want to kill him. He's in a heap of trouble when he is arrested in the garden and denied by his own followers. And he's in a heap of trouble when the guards begin to mock and to beat him. And he's in a heap of trouble when he stands before Pilate and the crowds begin to shout, "Crucify him, crucify him." And he's in trouble when Pilate hands him over to the shouting crowd, the crowd shouting, fist-shaking crowd, to be crucified. And once again, Mary is frantic with fear and worry. But this time she watches Jesus drag his own cross along the ground towards certain death. And his feet are nailed to the cross. And he cries out in pain and he struggles to breathe until finally his last breath is taken. "My son," Mary says, "is in a heap of trouble. And all that is left is that heap of flesh, lifeless heap of flesh and bones." For you see, it was the Father's business that took Jesus to the cross. It is the cross where God's promise of a Savior comes true for us, those who were adopted, predestined by the will of God to be His own. Because out of Jesus' death comes a resurrection to eternal life. And that means there is a resurrection to life and to immortality for us too. No longer are we in a heap of trouble. The empty tomb is God keeping His promise of comfort and hope for His people. His victory over death is our victory over death. Mary and Joseph may not have understood everything that day, at that time when they found Jesus in the temple. But as they headed back to their home, Mary treasured all of these things in her heart. And as we go back to our day, back to our homes this day, as we begin this new year, as we begin this new decade, we also keep and ponder these things in our hearts. Jesus Christ, Son of God, who has done and continues to do the Father's business. For it is through His Son that many sons and daughters are brought home to glory. Within the Father's house, the Son has found His home. And in His temple, suddenly, the Lord of life has come. Amen. May that peace which passes all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.